Hello everybody, this is Johns Hopkins with Baltimore Heritage, and we're back with another of our 5-minute histories videos, and today we're going to talk about the Mount Washington Mill. And I have to start by saying a quick thanks to two great researchers, Fred Shokin and Nathan Dennys, who put together a ton of wonderful information on this complex. So I bet a number of you out there have been to the Mount Washington Mill complex, maybe to go to Whole Foods or Starbucks or the wine store. But you may be asking, well, Johns, if you're at Mount Washington Mill, why aren't you in front of the mill buildings? What is that small red brick building behind you? Well, if you're like me, you may have also gone to the frame store, the frame in place, to get some artwork framed, and definitely to the ice cream store that are housed in this small red brick building. And in fact, the building behind me is part of the mill complex. It is a duplex house for workers. It was built as part of a series of housing in the 1830s, around 1835, and at its peak, it had about 40 different duplex houses for mill workers. All but one have been demolished to make way for the Jones Falls Expressway, but we have this one lone survivor behind me. And we'll talk about that in a second. But let's start a little bit earlier, back to 1808, which is when the mill got its start. It was started by a group of Marylanders, Baltimore businessmen, in response to Thomas Jefferson's embargo on the importation of manufactured goods. Jefferson was angry at England and France. They were at war, the Napoleonic Wars, and they were wreaking havoc on the high seas, including wreaking havoc on American ships. They were impressing our sailors. They were taking our goods. And to try to get even with them, he enacted this embargo, and it prohibited American ships from going overseas to foreign ports. And of course, that totally failed as a punishment for France and England. They continued to duke it out. Their economies were so big that our embargo barely put a dent in it. Who it hurt, of course, was all the American shipping interests, but it also hurt the Southern cotton growers. They had depended to a large extent on exports to England for their cotton, to places like Birmingham that had the growing industrial revolution with large mills taking American cotton and turning it into textiles. So in response, and in their incorporating papers, the Articles of Incorporation, the folks of Washington Cotton Company, that's what this was called, they specifically stated that they were doing so in response to Jefferson's embargo, and that was the reason that they thought this would be good for Maryland and also be successful. And it was pretty successful. By 1810, when they got going, they had 1,000 spindles. I think they had 7 looms and a dye house. And by the 1820s, they had been growing. But by 1840, the original owners sold the building to a gentleman named Fulton, I believe, who then quickly sold it to two other gentlemen that, if you're a mill aficionado, you'll know their names, Horatio Gambrels and William Hooper. These two folks had been buying up mills along the Jones Falls, lower down on the Jones Falls, in collecting what we know as the Mount Vernon Mill Company. I think 7 mills in total, including places like Mill Number 1 and Whitehall Mill that are still around today. When they bought this mill in the 1850s, it had been producing fine cloth for textiles, and they quickly converted it to produce cotton duck, a much thicker cloth. That's what they were doing in their mills downstream. Cotton duck was used predominantly for sailcloth, and their company became America's leading manufacturer of sailcloth. By World War I, their company was producing 80% of the world's sailcloth, so they were doing quite well. Hooper, maybe more than Gambrels. Hooper eventually became owner of the company and changed the name to William Hooper and Sons. So they're going strong, but after World War I, things are not looking so good. During the war, they had switched from producing sailcloth to producing the canvas that was used in the backpacks for U.S. soldiers abroad, as well as those classic army tents, those canvas army tents. But after the war, the demand for sailcloth was not so high. Steamships had taken over as the predominant form of ocean travel, and they started selling off mill mill buildings, including this one in 1923. They sold it to a company called the Maryland Bolt and Nut Company. So stayed on as manufacturing, but it changed from spindles and looms to forges and hardware. That's what it was doing. And it did pretty well for several decades until the 1970s. While it was a cotton mill and while it was a hardware mill, it had changes, many buildings built, some demolished. One thing that happened was an enormous fire in the 1940s that destroyed a lot of the main mill building where Whole Foods is now. In the rebuilding of it, we got the wonderful clear story of glass panes up at the top that just makes the building sparkle. So fire shaped this complex to a great extent, and so did floods. As anybody who knows who's driven on Falls Road during even a moderate and certainly a heavy rain, you can stand there and literally watch the Jones Falls filling up. It's actually pretty scary. In 1972, Hurricane Agnes did a whopper on this complex. It basically caked the mill machines in mud and in silt, kind of putting an end to that operation. The facility kept on as sort of light manufacturing for a number of years, and in the 1990s, Himmelrich & Company, a wonderful Baltimore redevelopment firm, bought the complex and turned it into what we have today. So let me wrap up with the buildings here. In 1808, when the mill got its start, we were 5 miles outside of Baltimore City, and the mill couldn't rely on the labor pool in Baltimore to come up here to run the mill. What they relied on were indentured servants, largely young boys. Maybe they were paying off the travel fare across the Atlantic, or maybe they were helping their families make ends meet. But by the 1830s, the mill owners had decided to build a village. This is the same era as mill villages that we know today as Woodbury and Stonehill, about that same time period. So they built here, they built a complex of 40 houses, 40 duplexes. Again, this is the only one still standing. So although it's sad that we no longer have a Mount Washington Mill Village, we do have this lovely reminder of sort of the human side of this milling operation. So I'm gonna close by inviting you to come down and maybe get an ice cream cone or bring some artwork to get framed, but get out of your car and walk around, take a look at this wonderful old building. And know one fact that you can't tell from the outside, but you can know in your head when you're walking around. Today, I believe the address is 1405 Forge Avenue. But before that, it was known as the number 30, and the street name was Hooper Avenue. And we know now for sure that the Hooper was none other than William E. Hooper, the king of cotton duck in Baltimore. All right, thanks so much, and we'll see you next time.